In this segment, we go through a number of related examples, which can all be solved using the same type of steps as for the particle in the box, with some suitable adaptations that we will discuss on the way. The main ingredient is just a slight generalization of free motion, namely to the case where the classical particle still does not experience any forces, because the potential is constant, but it does not vanish. Classically, we can then simply subtract this constant potential energy from the total energy to work out the kinetic energy. Quantum mechanically, exactly the same happens when we start from the Schrödinger equation, because we can bring the constant potential onto the other side and then solve this as before. So our solutions are plane waves, but in the wave number, the energy is replaced by the kinetic energy available to the classical particle. Now, classically, the kinetic energy cannot be negative. It involves the square of the momentum, but quantum mechanically, we can still find mathematical solutions when this happens. However, the wave number then becomes purely imaginary. We introduce a new real coefficient kappa here to keep working with real quantities. And when we use this to rewrite our solutions, we see that they become ordinary real exponential functions, which no longer oscillate but increase or decrease depending on the sign in the exponent. If this happens in a region that extends over all space to infinity, we have to rule these solutions out. They do not conform to our boundary conditions, even our most relaxed ones. But if these functions only occur in a finite region, we cannot just discard them. And in a semi-infinite region, we can only rule out one of the two. In any case, with these solutions at hand, both oscillatory ones and decaying ones, you can solve a relatively flexible set of problems, namely those where the potential is constant throughout regions and only jumps at the boundaries. What we will learn from this is more about energy quantization, resulting in the distinction of bound states and extended states. And we will also encounter a new effect, tunneling, which is precisely linked to the novel type of solutions given above, which occur when one operates outside of the range of classically accessible energies. To set the scene, we start with a simple variant of the particle in the box, namely a system with just a single hard wall. Classically, a particle will just be reflected from the wall. This changes the sign, but not the magnitude of the momentum, with both cases having exactly the same energy. Quantum mechanically, we can recycle the solutions from our first example. Namely, in the region where the particle moves freely, we have a superposition of two counterpropagating waves, with the wave number still related to the classical momentum by the de Broglie rule. And in the wall, where we again assume that the potential energy is infinite, the wave function must vanish because of our boundary conditions. And we have the continuity condition where the regions meet, which again dictates that the two amplitudes must be equal in magnitude and of opposite signs so that one obtains a node at the boundary between the two regions. But now we do not have a second boundary condition. The particle is free to be arbitrarily far to the left. And as it happens, because this region is infinitely long, the magnitude of the momentum is now well defined, without any uncertainty, only the sign will remain undetermined. So all we would like to know are the probabilities to find the particle to move to the right or to the left. And this is simply determined by the relative intensities of the two components. And we can even write this in a form that is always normalized. In our case, both intensities are equal, so the probabilities are both 1/2. Now, to put this into more physical terms, think of having a source of particles somewhere far left. This then means that all the particles are reflected. Interestingly, when we look at the momentum for any given particle, we would still find it with equal chances to move to the right or to the left. As it happens, this occurs because we presently insist to look at a stationary state with a fixed energy. In essence, in such a state, we will randomly find the particle before or after it has encountered the reflection with a hard wall. We will understand this a bit better later in the course when we will look at the time-dependent dynamics of quantum systems. But in any case, the take-home message for now is that the particle will always be reflected, as is also the case in the classical version of this problem. So we now contrast this to a case where we really make use of our new regions, where the potential is constant and finite. What I sketched here is known as a soft wall. It will assist our discussion a lot if we designate names to these regions, indicated here by the Roman numerals 1 and 2. Classically, we now have two cases. If the energy is still not enough to overcome this potential energy, the particle will always be reflected. It then really does not matter that the wall has a finite potential energy, it could just as well be infinite. It is actually a little paradoxical that a classical particle does not care how large the potential energy really is in this case. But this, of course, changes when you allow it to vary the energy, because when it exceeds the potential energy, the particle will always carry on. We will say that it is transmitted, adopting some wave physics language in anticipation of our quantum mechanical discussion. And it will then be transmitted with certainty. Now, as it moves into the region of the wall, the precise value of the potential energy in there actually matters. Namely, it reduces the kinetic energy available to the particle so that it moves more slowly, with correspondingly reduced momentum or velocity. Quantum mechanically, our solutions in both regions are still the pairs of counterpropagating plane waves, with the corresponding expressions for the wave numbers. The way it is written here is convenient when the energy is large enough so that the classical particle is always transmitted. In the other case, we change our notation as indicated before. So we have to distinguish exactly the same two cases as in the classical situation, even though our findings will be quite a bit more interesting. To keep things organized, we will first consider the case where the energy is larger than the potential energy in the wall, but we will do it in a way so that the other case will not require much extra work. So next we write down the boundary conditions at the point where the two regions meet. These are really the consequence of our general continuity condition, and as the potential is now finite, we need to require this both for the wave function as well as its derivative. These are now two conditions for four coefficients. This gives us some relations, but isn't very restrictive. Indeed, note that the particle can now escape to infinity into both directions. But physically, the scenario that we had in mind was a source of particles somewhere at the very left. So let us assume that there are indeed no particles arriving from the right. These correspond to the coefficient B2, which we therefore set to 0. We are also free to set A1 to 1. After all our solutions are only determined up to an overall constant. And we just need to be careful to later normalize our probabilities. So we added some assumptions simply to reflect a particular physical situation, namely exactly to the case where the coefficient B1 describes a reflected particle and A2 describes a transmitted particle. And as we have exactly two conditions for these two coefficients, we can now determine their values in a few algebraic steps. First, we rewrite the conditions, including our assumptions. Then we form the sum and the difference of these expressions. Next, we divide the difference by the sum, and this gives us the coefficient B1. So now, as before, we can use this to see if the particle can be reflected. And yes, it can. After all, this coefficient is finite. And this then translates into a corresponding reflection probability. It is generally less than 1, so there's also a finite chance of transmission, but we will come back to this a little bit later. In any case, this is very different from the classical case, where the particle is always transmitted. So now let us look at the case where the classical particle is always reflected. Here we have to use the real exponentials in region 2. But we can really only admit the one that decays into the region. The other violates our general boundary conditions. So this again dictates B2 equal to 0, but this is now a strict physical condition, not due to our choice to describe a certain physical scenario. Well, in any case, it means that by our algebraic steps, we already solved this problem. We just need to replace the wave number in region 2 by I kappa, and we are done. And now B1 is of the form of a complex number divided by its complex conjugate, but then its absolute value squared is just 1. So the particle is always reflected, just as in the classical case. And nonetheless, there is a significant difference. To see this, we have a look at the wave functions. Think of these sketches as, say, the real part of the wave function. In our first scenario, this oscillates in both regions with a constant amplitude throughout each, stretching to infinity as the particle can escape. Here, the particle has a finite chance to be transmitted or reflected, and this simply corresponds to the amplitudes of the different wave components. In the second scenario, the particle is always reflected, but the solution does not vanish in region 2. It simply decays exponentially. This decay becomes very drastic when we increase the potential energy, and in the limit of a hard wall, we approach the case of a vanishing wave function throughout this region. But now the height of the potential matters, and for the soft wall, the particle isn't completely confined to the region where it had moved classically. We call this phenomenon tunneling into a classically forbidden region. In our next example, we will extend this phenomenon even further to tunneling through a classically forbidden region. However, we have left an important gap, and we will fill this first, namely to properly define the transmission probability. This will require to take care of an innocent technical detail, which expands into a really quite interesting broader context that offers a completely different perspective on momentum. So we explicitly worked out the reflection probability in these problems, and it is clear that when the particle is not reflected, it will be transmitted. Well, unless it ends up trapped somewhere in space, so we better make sure. What we are dealing with here has a very general context, which is known as a scattering scenario. This is the situation where the particle is eventually free to move away ballistically. That's where I place the arrows. And in the middle, you can have an arbitrarily complicated system. Here, in one dimensions, at each energy and from either side, we have exactly one way to approach or recede from the target. These are just our counterpropagating plane waves in these regions. And furthermore, in these scenarios, you then specify where you place the source. Say at the very left, and then you are interested to see whether the particle returns into this direction, is reflected, or emerges on the other side, hence is transmitted. Now we already talked about the reflection probability, and this is indeed simply given by the ratio of the intensities of the incoming and outgoing wave components on the side of the source at the left. But when it comes to transmission, we need to take care of this one technical detail, namely that the two regions could have a different potential energy. So the particle is moving there with a different velocity. And we need to then include a factor into our definition of the transmission probability to take care of this. So let me explain where this comes from. First of all, the physical origin is quite simple. In basically any context, if you have a density-like physical quantity moving in space and it enters a region of, say, slower velocity, the density will pile up there. This can be best understood by looking at the current density, which you can write as the product of the density and the velocity. And if you have a stationary situation, this must be a constant throughout space. Now, in our case, we can actually apply this to the probability density and then derive what we really mean by this current. And if we do so, we can rephrase this indeed as an ordinary continuity equation, and we arrive at a really interesting little formula for the current density. Here, Im indicates the imaginary part. I have here written down the continuity equation for the stationary case that we are currently dealing with. So the temporal derivative actually vanishes, and the current then must be constant throughout space, just as I said. But I will show you the general case in a minute, and it results in the same expression for the current. The derivation is actually not that complicated and very instructive. But first we use this to justify our expression for the transmission probability. If we simply evaluate this probability current for a plane wave, we find that it indeed can be written as a probability density itself multiplied by a factor that we can interpret as a velocity. And when we apply the de Broglie rule, this velocity actually just looks like the classical velocity. So now in our scattering scenarios, the probability current is simply the intensity of this plane wave component multiplied by this velocity. And if we want to work out the reflection and transmission probabilities, we really want to look at the ratios of these quantities and not just the intensities themselves. And in our examples, this does not really matter for the reflection, because there we look at two wave components in the same region, which travel with the same velocity, just into opposite directions. But for transmission, this extra factor here appears, which really just accounts for the difference between these velocities. Scattering theory is very powerful. It can be extended to much more complicated situations, with many scattering modes describing different ways to approach the scattering region, which is a powerful way to think of quantum electronic transport, and even to the very drastic cases encountered in nuclear physics, where the target can break up, or high-energy elementary particle physics experiments, where totally different particles can be generated. But flux conservation, as encountered here, is a unifying principle for all these settings. So as promised, here is the derivation of the probability current for the general case with time dependence. The key step is to take the difference between the time-dependent Schrödinger equation and its complex conjugate after multiplying these by a factor so that the potential drops out. Here we use that the potential is always real. That will actually be guaranteed by our postulates. So taking this difference, the term which is underlined just drops out, and we get an expression that applies to all systems for any potential, even time-dependent ones. Now, in this expression, we can conveniently use the general rules of calculus to combine the derivatives. To verify this step, you can start from the result and work backwards using the product rule. So we arrive at a quite compact expression. At the end, we just need to cancel a common factor, and we get the continuity equation with the probability current now brought to the right-hand side. And when you look at its expression, it is just what we had written down before. So you can use this logic even when you look at non-stationary quantum dynamics, which will form its own chapter later in this course. Okay, now to wrap this segment up, let's see what we get for the transmission probability for the soft wall. Here I just copied our derivation of the coefficients from above, and so we can now take this reflection coefficient b1 and interpret its absolute value squared confidently as the reflection probability. And we can use our accurate expression for the transmission probability, into which we introduce this simple expression for a2. And finally, we can check that these probabilities add up to 1, as shown here. So we see that our definitions really work out in practice. For energies below the potential in the wall, we already saw that the particle is always reflected. In that case, A2 does not describe transmission, but tunneling into the classically forbidden region. Indeed, if you work out the probability flux for the real exponential in place of the plane wave, then it vanishes. In the next segment, we look at an even more important version of such tunneling, namely tunneling through a classically forbidden region, so that we obtain transmission where it classically isn't allowed.